couldn't fit his title the big font, which I had to make some choices. So I thought, you know, we have two different titles. But I didn't expect him to sort of question himself reading his title. But anyway, the point is, he defers to the two characters in honor of the characters. Thank you very much for inviting me. I'm happy to be here. I'm always happy to visit new places in Florida, where my wife's from. I've come to visit a few times, so it's a, one of these days, eventually, my objective is to visit St. Louis, which I've heard a few times. So, unfortunately, I'm leaving on this insanely early flight tomorrow. So, everything I'll see you again tomorrow. So, I'm gonna walk. Hotel. Thanks very much for inviting me. I managed not to get arrested while working on this presentation on the airplane. Two airplanes. So either people weren't looking at my screen, or maybe American citizens are more forbearing and tolerant than they're often made out in the media. So I ended up speaking a lot about this topic, freedom of expression, blasphemy of Islamic tradition. As you might imagine, because of things that have been in the news. Although I have to say, no matter how many times I talk about this, it always takes a lot of time to prepare a presentation for some reason. So that's why I was working on a deeper stem here. When we talk about this issue in American context, the Western context, we always think we talk about freedom of speech. Sometimes we talk about issues of blasphemy. This is actually a billboard that was outside of Memphis, Tennessee. Until recently, it was taken down, and it's a reproduction of the winning cartoon for the Draw Muhammad cartoon competition, put together by Pamela Geller and Murr, who's an organization for defense of democracy, I think, in Garland, Texas, last spring. And so it's an image of the Prophet, which the newspaper that I got this out of was nice enough to obscure. And he's angrily saying, "You can't draw me," and the artist's hand is saying, "That's why I draw you. Have to draw you because you're saying I can't." And so this is very much portrayed as an issue of principle in the Western media, fairly consistently. So the principle of freedom of speech has to be upheld, and it's so important that such a dear enlightenment value, an important value of many Western countries and the United States, that it has to be affirmed regardless of the cost. So that's very much how this issue is framed in the Western context. When we talk about this, let's say, issue of blasphemy or insulting the Prophet, depicting the Prophet, when you look at it from the Islamic perspective, or the perspective of Sharia, because obviously there's 1.5 billion Muslims in the world, they have lots of different perspectives, even though they might be some kind of your generalization about their views on this issue. Let's think about it from the perspective of Islamic law, Islamic legal system. How would Muslim legal scholars conceptualize this issue? And there's not... So in the Islamic tradition, there's not a category of blasphemy. There's not, and in fact, Muslim countries, let's say like Malaysia and Pakistan, that actually have blasphemy laws, those are actually British laws. Those are common law laws that remain part of the legal systems in this country. Islamic law doesn't have a category of blasphemy. When we talk about depicting the Prophet, insulting the Prophet, saying things you're not supposed to say, in the Sharia conceptualization, there's basically three kind of rubrics you fit this up. The first is the question of depicting living things, specifically things with souls. There's a bit of a question there whether or not you can depict animals, but definitely human beings, things with souls. There's a big, this is a very problematic in Islamic tradition, we'll discuss that. The second thing is that it depends who's doing the depiction, or let's say who's doing the insulting. So moving from the issue of depicting, let's just go to, let's say, insulting. If a non-Muslim living in an Islamic polity insults the Prophet, or maybe even a non-Muslim living outside an Islamic polity, that's a very different issue than if a Muslim insults the Prophet. I'll discuss these in the talk. I'm just giving you the kind of overall layout at the beginning. The third thing is, what if a Muslim insults the Prophet? That's a very different issue, and in fact, it's relatively simple. If a Muslim insults the Prophet, that Muslim has, at least in theory, exited the religion, committed apostasy or ridda in Arabic, iftidad, which is pretty serious. But we'll discuss this in depth. The theme that I want you to keep in mind, and that I'll try and remind you of as much as I can, is that in all these issues, context is very important. I don't just mean context, what's the exact circumstance of somebody says something, but the general surroundings of an issue. What are the political surroundings? What is the intention? What is the political meaning behind a statement, behind a drama? What's going on in the society? These are much more important in understanding how, not only how Muslims react to things, but also how, at least in theory, the Islamic legal tradition dictates this, how the response should be. So looking at the question of depicting creatures with souls, there's nothing in the Quran about this. Obviously the Quran, the Muslim kind of foundational scripture, it condemns graven images much like the Testament, so golden calf. The story of the golden calf is in the Quran as well. But the actual condemnation, or let's just say discouragement of depicting creatures with souls, comes from hadiths, from reports from the Prophet Muhammad. And you have two main ones, one in which لَا يَدْخُلَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ لَا تَدْخُلَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ بِيُوتْ فِيهَا سُورَةُ وَكَلْ, right? The angels don't enter houses or a house that have an image in them or a dog. And there's different versions of that hadith that have more details, but that's the main part. This is a hadith, it's in the two main collections, most respected collection of hadith in Sunni Islam. The second one is that another report in which the Prophet says that man sawwara fi dunya, someone who creates an image in the world, he will be asked on the day of judgment to breathe life into that. And he will not be able to be alive. And then presumably he'll feel bad or something. You know, that's not good. You don't want to be asked to do something on the day of judgment and not be able to do it. Assume this is a common. These are not explicit statements saying do never draw anything that has a soul. It's inferred from the condemnatory statement about this. Based on this evidence from the Prophet's, Prophet Muhammad's precedent, there is a very strong, very, very, very large majority of Muslim scholars, a lot of times people talk about it as a consensus of Muslim scholars, that you're not allowed to depict creatures with souls. And this would include painting, this would include sculpture, this would include, you know, bas-relief, or, you know, bas-relief in French, however you say, kind of mural or something like that. Anything in where you depict an image. What's very interesting, however, is that this is not a complete consensus. A lot of times people think this is a complete consensus of Muslim scholars, but there's actually some interesting dissenting voices from within the Islamic scholarly tradition. One figure from the 900s, that 947 commentary, Abu Ali al-Farisi, who's a scholar who wrote a commentary on the Quran. And in the Quran, there's a story in which the prophet King Solomon has these jinn, these spirits, are actually made, they're made his servants. And they perform these wondrous tasks. One of the things they do is they create sculptures. And another story in the Quran, Jesus breathes life into sculpted clay birds. So Abu Ali al-Farisi says, wait a second, if you're not allowed to create any sculptures whatsoever, any images of a living thing, then why does Jesus have a clay bird? Why is Solomon, a prophet of God, Jesus, prophets of God, can't sin, cannot commit sins? Why are they engaging in this activity? So what he argues is that you can create images as long as they're not images of gods or images that are part of idolatry, because that's the ultimate evil that is we seek to avoid here, is that people would worship the images they make. So as part of kind of avoiding that slippery slope, and you see this in those the hadith that I mentioned earlier, the reports, the fear is that human beings would become arrogant in their act, in their act of artistic creation, and that they'll think that this makes them like God. So the person who creates an image or a statue in this world, then on the day of judgment is asked to breathe life into it. The message is being delivered by this report is that God is the only creator. Human beings do not have creative capacity. In the Islamic tradition, always have a very, very strong emphasis on the division between God and creation. And that creation doesn't share any of God's powers, at least not to any degree that is comparable. So you kind of have, you can imagine sort of a slippery slope, the bottom of which, the end of which is idolatry. But that's not just I think the only thing Muslims are trying to avoid. There's also the sense that if you, as you slide down towards that, you pass another danger, which is that you, human beings think that they are creators like God. And that that act of artistic creation is a sort of arrogance, is an arrogant act. So what Al-Farisi is saying, there's nothing wrong with creating things because Solomon had things created for him. Jesus had this clay bird, completely didn't pray and say, don't give me any statues of clay birds. So he's saying the real message behind it is that you shouldn't create images that are going to be venerated. There's a very interesting figure named Al-Mukbani. He's a scholar from the 15th century in Cairo and Damascus, and he wrote a book on market inspection. It's called Hizba in Arabic or the Islamic. Basically going around being a market police, kind of public order policeman. And he talks about one of the duties in theory of someone doing this task of Hizba would be to go and, you know, oh, so you're selling this entire tray of pharaoh statues. I don't think so. I'm impounding these or something like that, preventing this from happening. What he says is there's no problem, however, if someone has images that are drawn on saddles or on carpets and things like that, because you're stepping on the carpet, you're sitting on the saddle, so there's no way that you're gonna go in and venerate these images. Similarly, by the way, another exception in one of the well-known reports from the Prophet on this issue, one of the companions of the Prophet says the Prophet exempted images done embroidered on cloth. So even in these original reports coming from the Prophet Muhammad or attributed to the Prophet Muhammad, you have already some blurring lines about some exemptions. However, when you look at the majority of Muslim scholars, they'll, in the classical period up until the modern period, they'll all say any images, especially of human beings, are completely prohibited. In the 20th century, early 20th century, there are some Muslim scholars, granted these are modernists, right? So these are people who believe that Islam as a religion and a religious system needs to be greatly reformed in order to meet the what they consider the very valid expectations of the modern world. A lot of Muslim scholars don't share those views. They don't want it. They don't think they should, Muslims should engage in that kind of change to their religious tradition. But some scholars, like the Egyptian scholar Muhammad Abdu, who died in 1905, he has a famous fatwa or a legal opinion in which he argues, again, like some early scholars like Al-Farisi, that the purpose of this prohibition is to avoid idolatry. People in Egypt in 1900 are not going to worship a statue of Pharaoh that some guy has made to sell to a British tourist. It is obviously a tourist item. No one's going to worship this. No one is going to get confused. So he kind of says we should forget about what appears to be the sort of letter of the law, which has been taken so seriously until this time, and look more at the objective of the law, which is to prevent worship. Okay. Any questions about this so far? Evidently, I'm doing a really good job of explaining myself. What about, so that's the law. What about reality? Again, I want to emphasize here, context is very important. It affects things, and so does culture. So does culture. And I'm going to engage in some really crude cultural kind of generalizations here. I would be more apologetic about it, except that they're so accurate in this case. Really, you can, I'll explain that. One of the theories that when scholars look back on the early Islamic period and the development of Islamic law is that they say this prohibition on images is a later development. It's unclear, there's no clear answer to that. Obviously, Muslim scholars believe this originates with the Prophet Muhammad. Many Western scholars are skeptical of that. One of the reasons they're skeptical is because if you look at some of the earliest surviving Islamic art, which just happens to be palatial art in the palaces and bathhouses of the Umayyad dynasty, which reigned in Syria from 662 750 in the Common Era, you see images like this. It's from it's now, I think, unfortunately, been, actually, this has been restored. This is actually an image of the restoration. It's been all blacked out by fire. This is at the place called Qusay al-Amra in Jordan, where Jordan or Syria. And there's this image of, I think it's four kings. There's the Byzantine emperor, the Persian emperor, the Ethiopian emperor, and I can't remember who the other person is. I think maybe the Umayyad caliph himself. And they're just completely, I mean, you can see this is a person depicted in artistic style. It's very reminiscent of Byzantine art. And in fact, early Umayyad art really borrows on Byzantine style. And in fact, they actually hired Byzantine artists to build things like the decorations in the Umayyad mosque in Damascus. So you see things like that. You say, what if there's this prohibition on imagery, why do we have these images being made? There's a couple of potential explanations. One of them is that rich and powerful people don't care about what Muslim scholars say. This is definitely true. Okay, I mean, few and far between are the Muslim ruler who is personally pious in every way. Most of the time they try to be a good Muslim, but they love drinking, for example. They try to be a good Muslim, but they love killing people too. That sounds bad. I meant medieval Muslim rulers here. Turkic warlord type people. This is expected. So, maybe it's just a lot of only really wealthy people or upper middle class people can even imagine that existed are going to have the money to engage in this kind of creation of art or purchasing of art. So maybe it's just the rich and powerful people don't really feel they need to follow this law all the time. Another, it's unfortunately just an undeniable fact. Is that when you look at the Muslim world, the Persianate world, the world that was created and informed by Persian artistic, literary, court, political sensibilities, and this is really kind of begins after the 1200s of the Common Era, with the Mongol conquests and the conquest then of Tamerlane, and then the successor states of this period are things like the Ottoman Empire, the Mughal Empire in South Asia, the Safavid Empire. If you look at the Muslim world from Turkey all the way through Central Asia to Iran down into India, you see the same kind of artistic styles, really up until the early modern period. And one of the things you see fairly consistently is they do not care about portraying not only human beings, they don't care about portraying the Prophet. So this is an image of the Prophet Muhammad, probably one of the earliest images that's known from the 13th century from a Persian manuscript, and this is the Prophet Muhammad preaching. Of course, he doesn't look like an Arab, at least not to me. What does he look like? Anybody? He looks like he's East Asian, yeah? Because that was the artistic self. So either way, this is not a mimetic depiction of the Prophet Muhammad. Here's another very early image from the world history of a famous scholar. He was a scholar, he was a vizier, he was the grand vizier of the Ilkhans. He died in 1381, and the author of the first, or the compiler of the first world history, a guy named Rashid ad-Din. And this is the image of the Prophet Muhammad, who's helping, before he's a prophet, he's actually helping to put the final stone in the Kaaba, which is a story from his life before he became a prophet. Go back here. So one of the arguments is that there's just, the Persianate tradition somehow just has indifference to this restriction. Why? Well, the famous Mughal emperor Akbar the Great, who died in 1605, he actually gives a justification for not only portraying images, but portraying images of the Prophet. So he says, when you're portraying an image, you're not thinking you're like God. In fact, when you're an artist drawing a picture, you're actually reminded of how insufficient your ability to create is. It doesn't have to be an act of arrogance, it can be an act of actually reminding yourself of your low status. It can be a humbling experience. And then, not the Emperor Akbar, but many other Muslims who supported this, especially in the courts of great Muslim rulers would say drawing a picture of the Prophet Muhammad can be a useful tool of worship because it allows you to focus on his character, on emulating him. Again, these are explanations that are not going to convince Muslim jurists, but the great thing about being an emperor is you don't have to worry about that because you're the most powerful person. What's fascinating is that in the Arab world, you just don't see this. As far as I know, I don't know of any instance of depiction of the Prophet Muhammad. And certainly very, very rare is the depiction of a living thing in art. So just an example of this, in the 1830s and 40s, when the Ottoman Empire was going through a process of modernization called the Tanzimat period, reorganization period, one of the things they did is Ottoman sultans wanted to kind of emulate some of the court practices of European monarchs. So the Ottoman sultan said, okay, I want to take a portrait of the sultan put in every government office. And the religious scholars, the Muslim religious scholars in the kind of Ottoman heartland of Istanbul, Constantinople, Anatolia, the Balkans, they said, that's great, we have no problem with that. When they tried to implement this in the Arab provinces of the Ottoman Empire, there was tremendous reaction and refusal, or at least disapproval by the religious scholars in the Arab provinces. Anybody have any questions? I know there's Q&A, but sometimes I'm going to talk about different things. Maybe something that I can't survive unless I have this question. I don't want to be responsible for anybody. Okay. Now, so that's the issue of depiction of the Prophet. Now, the issue of depiction of the Prophet and insult of the Prophet are linked, but certainly, you know, none of these images I showed you before were Muslims. No Muslims got insulted. Really, this becomes an issue when you get to the 20th century. And so many Muslim scholars, the majority of Muslim scholars, let's say, approved of photography and approved of film. So you can take a photo, the majority of Muslim scholars, since the introduction of photography in the late 1800s, and the introduction of moving pictures in the 20th century, majority of Muslim scholars have approved of this. Why? Because there's no creative action involved. You're basically capturing light. Some very conservative Muslim scholars don't even accept that. The vast majority have. But even those who support or approve of, let's say, movies, there has generally been very strong rejection by Muslim scholars of the possibility of having someone portraying the Prophet. So you don't want to, first of all, it's a lot of pressure on whatever actor, even if it's Russell Crowe, Leonardo DiCaprio, gets picked to play the Prophet. It's a lot of pressure because for Muslims, the Prophet Muhammad is the most perfect of all creation. So it doesn't matter how good, even if Benedict Cumberbatch, my wife doesn't think he's that good. Maybe. Someone who all, Ryan Gosling, there you go, right? Even Ryan Gosling cannot live up to the expectation that Muslims have of the Prophet's perfection. So there's sort of a, when you have a person portraying him, it's almost inevitably reducing his status, at least in theory. And then, of course, the majority of people, as you can imagine in the world today, many people who want to make movies about the Prophet Muhammad are not going to portray him positively. So it's sort of, there's a very clear sense that this is a slippery slope. This is an invitation that people insult him. So that's why, even if you see this movie from the 1970s called The Message, which has Anthony Quinn as Hamza in it. Right? Yeah. It's a very weird movie because you don't see the main protagonist, or even the first four caliphs are not portrayed. So they're referenced off screen, but it's an interesting movie to watch. It's a very good movie. Okay. When it comes to Muslims insulting the Prophet, this is actually very simple. As I said before, Muslims, you insult the Prophet, don't insult the Prophet. It's a bad thing because according to the consensus, and here we really have, I don't know of any Muslim who doesn't do this throughout history, there's really strong consensus that if a Muslim belittles or insults God, belittles or insults the Quran, belittles or insults the Prophet Muhammad, then this person ceases. That is an act that removes the person from the pale of Islam. And unless they repent, then the, this is a topic for some other lecture, the for apostasy for Muslims in classical Islamic law is a death penalty. So this is not a good thing to do because this is a very serious punishment. And just to show, you know, how clearly Muslim scholars want to mark this as a red line, you don't even want to get anywhere near. There was lots of debates, for example, what happens if you go and you call someone, son of a bitch, and it turns out that person's mother is a descendant of the Prophet. So most Muslim scholars would say, okay, didn't know she was a descendant of the Prophet, so that's fine. I mean, this is not a good thing to do, but some Muslim scholars, for example, Qadi Iyad, a 12th century scholar from Cordoba, he said, even if you don't know the person's descendant of the Prophet, this is it, you've insulted the Prophet, this is a death penalty. And in fact, in the 1349, there's a Christian, no, sorry, yeah, sorry, there's a Muslim who gets accused of, he calls another person, you know, basically says, you're a bastard, you're Ibn Kelb, you're the son of a dog. And that person's a descendant of the Prophet, and this person is brought up on charges of insulting the Prophet, and eventually he's acquitted because the judge determined there wasn't enough evidence. But the point is, this actually wasn't just a theoretical discussion, but actually could be brought into court for this. This is, the evidence for this is primarily from the Quran, and not from the sayings of the Prophet. So, and it's not sort of stated explicitly in the Quran, but the Quran over and over again talks about how the unbelievers during the life of the Prophet, the previous communities who rejected God's messages, they all mocked the prophets who came to them. So, like, ma yatihim min nabiyyin illa kanu bihim yastehzi'un, right? They, no prophet came to them except that they used to mock him. So the unbelievers are always characterized by this mocking of prophets. So you see this so often in the Quran, it becomes very clear that mocking God, mocking the Prophet, mocking God's messages is one of the actions and characteristics of unbelievers. What's interesting is in the actual Sunnah of the Prophet, I didn't define that, I should have, which is the authoritative precedent of the Prophet Muhammad, which is one of the major sources of law for Muslims. There's almost no evidence in the life of the Prophet of him killing Muslims for insulting him. So there's a very famous episode. When the Prophet Muhammad went to Medina in 622 of the Common Era, and the Muslims who moved to the city are actually a minority here. The majority are polytheist Arabs and Jews, Jewish Arabs. Okay? A number of the leading polytheists start converting to Islam, but many of them, especially the powerful ones, are not sincere converts. So they continue to try and undermine the Prophet's new leadership role in the city, and they actually consistently insult him, sometimes to his face, sometimes behind his back. And in one instance, one of the leading, they're called hypocrites, one of these hypocrites, Abdullah bin Ubay, he's insulting the Prophet behind the Prophet's back. One of the Prophet's close friends and second caliph of Islam, Omar bin Khattab, goes to the Prophet, says, "Oh, Messenger of God, let me kill him. Let me strike his head off for this." And the Messenger of God says, "Leave him. I don't want people to say Muhammad kills his companions." So what's interesting about this is that he doesn't bring up a principle. He doesn't say Omar killing people is wrong, or Omar freedom of speech. He says the reaction to this, or people are going to say, is that they're going to say, "I kill members of my own people." And it's very interesting that in the right after that, the narrator of this report says that the Muslims who were immigrants who came from Mecca at the time were a minority in the city, and the majority of Muslims in the city were actually the native Muslims of Medina, of which this person, this hypocrite, was one of the leaders. So there's almost this understanding that in it was the context was such that it would have been destructive, highly destructive, if the Prophet had punished, or let's say, had this person killed for the insult. What's interesting is it's not just Muslims in the polity of Medina who go unpunished for insulting the Prophet. It's also the non-Muslims there. So you have, there's an example when some of the Jews who were living in Medina, the Prophet couldn't, lost some of his camels. And they came to him and they mocked him and said, you know, you're supposed to be a prophet of God who knows the unseen, you don't even know where your own camel is. And he had lots of instances where either people who were hypocritical Muslims or non-Muslims living in Medina would insult the Prophet, and he never punished them. As far as I know, he never punished anybody inside the polity of Medina, even non-Muslims. And I think it was because of this concern. As the Constitution of Medina said, this is one ummah, one community. They may work together, they may peace together, even if they're not all Muslim. Some of them are atheists, polytheists, some of them are Muslims, some of them are Christian or Jewish. The Prophet didn't want to have the negative impact of killing other people in that community for insulting him. Yes?
So then what's the basis of the government?
That's a great question. Good thing it's in this slide. I'll answer your question. Your mind is following the flow of the discussion. Okay. Actually, the evidence for the death penalty, I should actually rephrase it. There are some reports that are not in the main hadith collections, but in, for example, those of you who are interested, books like the Sunan al-Bayhaqi, died 1066 of the Common Era. So you have some later hadith collections that include reports, for example, from companion Ibn Abbas saying that, telling the Prophet, saying a man came to the Prophet and said, my wife cursed you, so I killed her. And the Prophet says, Demuha Mahdur, her blood was lit. Her blood was licit. It's okay if you kill her. The reason I didn't mention these hadiths is that they're, even Muslim scholars don't necessarily consider them very reliable. I'm not talking about Western scholars and reliability. Even Muslim scholars, these hadiths don't get added in as the main piece of evidence for the death penalty punishment for insulting the Prophet. They're like saucing gravy on top or something like that. But the main evidence comes from the way that the Prophet interacted with people outside Muslims. This is what I'll tell you about right now. What about non-Muslim subjects of a Muslim polity? Or even non-Muslim subjects who are outside that polity, maybe even in enemy policies. One of the lines of thought, or one of the schools of thought you've seen in the Islamic illustration is, goes back to the great scholar of southern Iraq, Abu Hanifa, founder of one of the major schools of law. He died 767 of the Common Era. What he says is that, okay, if Christians and Jews and Zoroastrians and Hindus and everybody else are allowed, who live under a Muslim rule, are allowed to keep their religion. So if you're a Christian and you live in Islam, you're allowed to practice as a Christian. Now, if you're a Christian, you know about Islam, there's all these Muslims all around you, either, by definition, either you don't believe the claims of the Prophet Muhammad, or you think the Prophet Muhammad was a crazy person or a liar or something like that. But you certainly, there's no, you're not accepting his claim as a prophet, so by definition, you're insulting him. What Abu Hanifa said is, if non-Muslims are allowed to preserve their religion, which inherently include an insult to the Prophet Muhammad, then how can we punish them by death, for example, for coming out and calling the Prophet Muhammad, you know, something bad? Their very religious existence is already an insult. So if we're not going to punish them for that, if they're allowed to keep their religion, which nobody, everybody agreed, all Muslims far as away, these people can keep their religious, they can continue to practice their religion, they can continue to live in their religious communities under Muslim rule. By definition, we can't punish them we can't punish them by something as severe as death. So what he said is that you can punish, let's say, a Christian who insults the Prophet Muhammad in another way. You can imprison him, you can do something, but you can't execute him. So that's one position. The majority position of the Muslim schools of law is that it's up to the ruler to decide. This is not something where Muslim scholars are going to come and give you a clear rule. If a Christian or, say, a non-Muslim living under Muslim rule, consult the Prophet Muhammad, X has to be done. They would say, this issue is, we defer to the political judgment of the ruler on this. And what was their, how do they arrive at this conclusion? Precisely because the decisions that the Prophet made regarding this were political decisions. So one of the most famous, the most the piece of evidence that were most considered most reliable by Muslim scholars are the killing of someone named Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf. Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf is a, it's unclear, he's either a polytheist Arab or he's a Jewish Arab. He moves to Medina to join the Muslim community. He becomes Muslim. Then he doesn't like being Muslim. He likes to say insulting things about the Prophet. He leaves Medina. He goes to Mecca, where the enemies of the Prophet were at the time. And he actually, according to some reports, he goes to the Kaaba and he calls many of the enemies of the Prophet there, the leaders of the Quraysh tribe, and he says, I want you to take an oath that you're going to continue to fight the Prophet until Islam is defeated. So not only is he insulting the Prophet, he's writing insulting poetry about the Prophet. In some reports, he's even getting, you know, singing girls to come and sing the insulting poetry about the Prophet. Actually, that was another guy, Ibn Khattab, I'm sorry. It's another guy who did the singing girls. But he's also seemingly recruiting people to fight against the Prophet. So the Prophet orders two of his companions, Mu'adh ibn Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Muhammad ibn Maslama. He basically sends a team to assassinate Ka'b, and they assassinate him. This is the most famous and well-authenticated report in the Islamic tradition about that has the Prophet killing, having someone assassinated for, it seems, insulting. Now, what you see, and even Muslim scholars discuss this, is they say, it wasn't that he was insulting the Prophet. He was, as one scholar in the 15th century, Ibn Hajar says, he was muharib. He was actively fighting the Prophet. He was going and recruiting people to fight Muslims. And so you can see there's a very clear political element here, especially because the Jews living in Medina weren't punished for insulting the Prophet. Only this figure who's actually out there working with the enemy against him. This is another thing where you have to be careful about the sources you read, because there's a story of the Prophet ordering a woman named Asma bint Marwan, who's a poet, she's an Arab poet from another tribe, ordering her assassinated for insulting her. That's one of the few instances where you see the story say the Prophet had this person assassinated because they insulted him. But this report, you find it in, just for those of you who are interested, the Sirah of Ibn Ishaq, which has a lot of unreliable material in it, but it doesn't appear in any hadith collection that I know of. It only appears in some early historical sources, which are considered by Muslim scholars to be highly, highly unreliable. So that piece of evidence isn't used as a piece of evidence by Muslim scholars because it's they don't consider it to be a reliable report. When we look at Islamic civilization and Islamic history, you see that the way, again, context matters. It's often political considerations. I don't mean political considerations like, you know, I'm a Republican, my friend's a Democrat, but I'm going to pretend to be angry at them because it's a presidential election. I don't mean that kind of political consideration. I mean that these decisions are often about the environment and people's perceptions of power and their relationship to one another. Majoritarian politics, minoritarian politics, communal politics. These are really, seem to be what define the way that Muslims and Islamic law functions regarding insulting the Prophet Muhammad and blasphemy in general, just saying, let's say, rejected things in general. In situations in which Muslims are in cultural and positions of cultural and civilizational confidence, there tends to be complete disregard for non-Muslims insulting the Prophet. So there's a one example, there's a British traveler in Mughal India in, I think, between 1612 and 1619. His name is Thomas Carrot, C-A-R-Y-E-T. Carrot sounds good to me. So he travels in Mughal India in the early 1600s, and he learns enough Arabic. He says, he goes around saying, there's no God but God, and Jesus is the Son of God. And then he says Muhammad is an imposter. And people just, what are you, you're crazy. So people just said I was crazy and didn't do anything. Nothing happened to him. A lot of the books that we have written by Muslim scholars on the issue of non-Muslims insulting the Prophet are written because that Muslim scholar is extremely annoyed or objects to the fact that a non-Muslim has insulted the Prophet and has not been punished. So one of the most famous books called the Saif al-Maslul, the drawn sword against those people who insult the Prophet, the Messenger of God, by a scholar from Damascus named Suki, who died in 1356. He starts the book out saying, and the book is this thing, it's a huge book, right? He starts out saying, I've written this book because a Christian came and insulted the Prophet, and the Sultan didn't do anything to him. And although, as a Shafi scholar, I defer to the ruler on his decision, I'm going to tell you why this is the wrong decision. And so, the books that have become the references in Islamic, in the Islamic kind of library for the issue of people insulting the Prophet are oftentimes, at least in the case of Suki and Ibn Taymiyyah, written by people who are writing rebuttals of what they see as an overly tolerant, overly accommodating ruler. This changes in situations in which there is communitarian tension or communal tension. So, for example, in Egypt remains a Christian majority region through the 1100s. And even today, there is anywhere between 10-15% of the Egyptian population is Christian. So, until the 1100s, Egypt is a majority Christian. A lot of people don't remember this, that Muslims are a very small minority in the places they conquer for many centuries. In the 1300s, especially in Cairo, you have a lot of riots between Christians and Muslims. It's also a time when the Black Plague is striking there, so in 1348, you have a really serious case of the Black Plague. It's a devastating effect on the economy and the population there. And so you have a lot of social tension. In that period, you see a number of Christians who are brought, I think 5 or 6 cases of Christians who are brought to Sharia courts and punished for insulting the Prophet. The opposite of situations of civilizational cultural confidence are situations of civilizational marginalization, being dominated, being occupied, being killed by, let's say, American soldiers. In those situations, you see that this is when you see tremendous sensitivity in Muslim communities towards the person of God. So, a Muslim minority living in France is not in a position of power, not in a position of confidence. And there you see a lot more sensitivity towards the figure of the Prophet. It can be the opposite of the Muslims in a position of confidence. This is just a picture of Prophet Muhammad, a 16th century book, and he's, you see his face here is covered, so they don't want to depict him. And he's pointing at the moon, which is split as a miraculous sign. I know I've gone 40 minutes, but I want to take 10 more minutes, if it's okay with you. I have more pictures, don't worry. I want to switch the direction of our analysis here and look at the Western tradition. The first thing to keep in mind is, despite the whole Je suis Charlie and sacrifice on the altar of freedom of expression, there's no such thing as absolute freedom of expression. There's no society where there's absolute freedom of expression. If you want to test that, go and make a porno movie with kids involved, or go yell fire at a crowded theater, or go question Tom Cruise's sexual orientation or talk about Satire or in a magazine article. There's defamation, there's pornography, there's notions of causing imminent threat of a lawless act or clear and present danger in the case of a legal tradition. So there's all sorts of speech that even the United States, which has the most robust regime of protection of freedom of expression. There's still expression that is illegal, that is criminalized, that will have consequences, legal consequences. In European law, you have much more restrictions on freedom of expression. There you have notions of public order, which you don't really find very often in the United States. There, in many European countries, hate speech is criminalized. In, for example, in France, in the Netherlands, in Belgium, in Germany, in Denmark, I'm not sure about Norway, but producing Nazi propaganda, distributing Nazi paraphernalia is illegal. Denying the Holocaust or questioning the number of people who were killed in the Holocaust is illegal, but you can fine significant amounts of money for this. Just an example of public order in the United States, where public order is mentioned, despite defenses made in the name of freedom of expression, women cannot, in almost all municipalities in the United States, women cannot walk around topless. I think in New York you're allowed to. I mean, almost nowhere in the United States can you walk, can a woman walk around topless. And some, consistently over the last 30 years, some women have challenged this in the courts, saying this is, we want to engage in freedom of expression, artistic expression, by removing our tops. We're being discriminated against. Our expression is being prevented, restricted. And courts in the United States have consistently rejected this argument. So, no, our morality in this country said this would be a violation. So, what you see, because there's no such thing as absolute freedom of expression, when people, when you look at what freedom, the restrictions, what restrictions there are, these restrictions are really statements about who belongs and who doesn't belong, what is acceptable and what isn't acceptable. What is acceptable for a citizen or a member of a community? In a way, it defines the notion of civility in society. And it says what is okay and what is not okay, and who gets to define what those things are. So this is an act of power. It's an act of domination, oftentimes an act of domination by the majority of minority communities. And in these situations, we are all blinded by our pasts. Just an example. This is from 2005 in France. There was an advertisement in, I think it was a billboard, and the French court, it was upheld throughout the French system, banning this advertisement that had a depiction of the Last Supper, which I think was a fashion. And if you look at the French court's argument, it said, this insults the religious feelings of Catholics. The same country where people, you know, the freedom of expression, a magazine, Charlie Hebdo, was allowed to publish two horribly insulting editions, insulting Muslims and the Prophet Muhammad, egregiously. And this was defended by members of society and by the government, saying this is important for freedom of expression. The same country, same legal system said, they're going to ban this ad because it insults the religious feelings of Catholics. In the UK in 2010, this advertisement, UK advertising authority, forced the magazine to remove this ad that had a pregnant nun eating ice cream because it said this causes serious offense to readers, particularly Roman Catholics. This, just 2 days after the Charlie Hebdo attack, about 1 year ago, pretty much, just 2 days, the French comedian Dieudonné Mbala Bala, his performance was banned, and the ban on it was upheld by the highest French administrative court. He was not allowed to perform as a comedian because he has some jokes which are, some people say, anti-Semitic, and he does this sign. He actually is doing it here. It's sort of this like inverted Sieg Heil sign. And what the French court said is it's banned because of the reality and gravity of the risk to trouble. The risk of trouble to public order. So French court banned this comedian from performing because of the risk it posed to public order, but it didn't ban or prevent Charlie Hebdo from publishing, even though it had already been demonstrated 2 years prior to this, it had already been an attack on the Charlie Hebdo newspaper. The French courts already knew that this was a threat to public order. And in the 2 weeks after the Charlie Hebdo attack, over 50 people in France, some of them as young as children, were arrested and detained for statements that were seen as supportive of terrorism. Again, acts of expression. Just to stress, context is so important. even the United States, which has, I'm very proud to say, extremely strong regime to support a freedom of expression. In 1940, there's a famous Supreme Court case called Minersville versus Gobitis. The Gobitis family children, they wanted to remain silent during the Pledge of Allegiance, the school. And the school, first, scolded them, then it suspended them from school. And so the question was, does the school have the right to make you say, public school have the right to make you say Pledge of Allegiance? And to remain silent is a form of expression. So what the Supreme Court says in 1940 is, yes, the school has a right to make you say the Pledge of Allegiance. Just 3 years later, the Supreme Court, many of the same justices, reverses the decision completely. In another case, Virginia versus Barnett. 1943, it says, no, the school cannot make you say Pledge of Allegiance. Does anybody think why that might be? That's how the Pledge of Allegiance used to be said. Now we say this. This used to be... Maybe, I don't know, 1940, 1943, is there anything going on at that time, right? 1941, the U.S. entered World War II, and the last thing you want to do is say the school is going to make you do the Sieg Heil, basically, to the American flag. So look how much the court completely changes the opinion. Nothing can change except the context. And just to give you one last example, and then I'll be done. In August of 2012, in the Jewish publication, The Forward, you can see it. I mean, I even checked up to make sure today when I was in the airport, free Wi-Fi. They said 2012, The Forward has this great article. It says, the article is kind of rejoicing that YouTube had taken down several hundred anti-Semitic videos that had been uploaded. August 2012, YouTube. September 11, 2012, what happens? There's this Innocence of Muslims, Innocence of Muslims video. It's a kind of a movie trailer, a movie that never got made. It's put on YouTube. When I was writing my book on the Prophet Muhammad, I either read about every insulting thing that's ever been said about the Prophet Muhammad. This was the most offensive thing that's ever been said or made about the Prophet Muhammad, I feel confident. I mean, it breaks new ground in offensiveness. It's really offensive. Okay. If you look at YouTube's freedom of speech policy, it's very clear. They don't allow hate speech. Anything that, we don't permit hate speech which demeans or a group based on race, ethnic origin, religion, disability, gender, age, veteran status, sexual orientation, or gender identity. So they don't permit speech that attacks or demeans a group based on these things. The U.S. government actually tried to get YouTube to take, was I saying Facebook, I meant YouTube. The U.S. government tried to get, indirectly, get YouTube to take this down. It's causing this real problem. And eventually YouTube took it down in Pakistan, I think Afghanistan. But YouTube said, this does not violate our hate speech policy. So the most offensive thing, in my opinion, the most offensive thing ever made by human beings about the Prophet Muhammad did not violate YouTube's hate speech policy, but hundreds of videos that some members of the Jewish community considered to be anti-Semitic were removed from YouTube just 1 month before because they were considered to be anti-Semitic. So, the moral story is context matters. It is not a defense of freedom, in my opinion, it is not a defense of freedom of speech to defend the right of armed white males in Texas to insult Muslims, to insult someone who Muslims revere. Because what this is really saying to Muslims is, you who are already a disenfranchised minority, already a besieged minority in this country, we're going to step on those things you consider to be valuable and sacred because we're going to show you that you can only care about the things we say you care about. The things you care about, we get to decide what gets accepted. You might think you're citizens of this country. What you think is important does not have any effect on our notions of civility. It's legal to say things that are anti-Semitic in the United States. People don't do it. It's legal to use the N-word in the United States. People don't do it. because it has been clear in discussions about our notions of civility in this country that these things are not to be done, because they offend fellow citizens who are supposed to care about them. When Muslims are told that their sensibilities are not taken into consideration, it means that they're not being held as full citizens. You see this even more clearly in Europe, where a country like France, where you have 7-8% of the population is Arab/Muslim. Germany, 5% of the population is Turkish/Muslim. Huge percentage of the population are being told that their sensibilities are not going to be taken into consideration by the government. Okay, sorry for going over time, about 15 minutes. I'll be happy to answer questions or have, you know, food or something. Good manners from the South, no one ever claps. Any questions, comments? Yes.
Someone pointed out a problem to me that it becomes a matter of getting enough people to react as strongly as they can, and then that gets a mob. They call it a mob veto. And so, how could you?
So, and this is a kind of a weird presentation because I went from classical Islamic law to modern identity politics, but they're connected. So I think one of the things is, if you look in not just American history in the second half of the 20th century, but I imagine if you go back even further, what you see is the why are we making such a big deal out of it defense, or why can't we just be polite defense? This is a don't rock the boat defense is used by the majority or by the status quo to prevent the concerns of a group that feels marginalized or besieged from being hurt. So oftentimes when you see, take the example, the events that happened at University of Missouri. So people say, why is it such a big deal? Or Yale, it's just Halloween costumes, right? And you know, you can see that, if every day we all went around and we were all kind of like political correct police and you're not respecting my positionality or my intersectionality, we'll never be able to interact with each other. We have to have some degree of charity. But that can't be used to say that a group that has been marginalized, that does feel underrepresented, does feel hostility towards it, you can't just say that anytime they raise that concern that they're rocking the boat. So in a sense, the majoritarian control of discourse in this country, discourse in liberal democracies where it can't be done, or at least most liberal democracies, ideally, it shouldn't be done through the law. It has to be done through kind of a social consensus that's built up and argued over and then built up, is you have to go out and organize around a position. Because if you don't, no one's ever going to take you seriously. If Muslims in Europe, let's say, just stopped working or something like that, until a certain magazine was closed or something like that, or until a certain politician apologized, if they could have that much of an impact on the economy in those countries, you better believe that there would be changes in the law or certainly changes in public attitude. Same thing in the United States. When the football team at University of Missouri decided we're not going to play, then the president was gone the next day. Because they were going to lose, you know, twice his salary the next day. So I think that there's a tough argument, because some people say don't complain, don't do this mob, don't organize some mob veto. But if you don't organize a mob veto in the discourse of liberal democracy, you never mobilize your support. Yes.
So every time a KFC gets burned down in Pakistan, you know, following a riot or something, I find that we have the internal dialogues in the Muslim community deciding, well, obviously some people are very upset, and should we be similarly upset? So we're trying to rationalize, what should our response be?
Should we be upset about a KFC being burned down?
No, not that. But so for instance, when there's a riot over the depiction of the Prophet and a subsequent riot, for instance, what is our response here? And a lot of times I agree that there's a sort of helpless defense where, oh, don't worry about it, it's political free speech, so it'll blow over. So I'm trying to gauge, you know, what is the right response? So certainly the right response is not rioting
down
the streets.
KFC is not free speech.
No, I'm not saying that, but my point is the level of intensity with which people try to defend the honor of the Prophet in other places is incredible. Versus our approach here tends to be much more passive.
Yeah,
so the question is, there's one thing of, well, do nothing if someone depicts the Prophet in an insulting way. Another way is riot in the streets. And what's the right balance?
I mean, one of the things you see, I think you see it pretty clearly in the not only the precedent of the Prophet, but also in the instances I mentioned in Islamic history with the Sharia courts, is, you know, the Christians who were, let's say, accused of insulting the Prophet, or might even have been executed for insulting the Prophet, they weren't executed by a mob. They were brought to a court, and they were, you know, they had a trial. So obviously, due process is extremely important. Vigilante justice is unacceptable. The instances I mentioned in the life of the Prophet, where, let's say, he has Ka'b ibn al-Ashraf assassinated, he sent people to do this. The instance in which the man says, my wife insulted you, I killed her, the Prophet says, her blood was licit. That's actually, it's in the Sunan of Abu Dawud, it's a hadith collection from the 9th century. That's actually an unreliable hadith. So for me, as a Muslim, I don't accept that hadith because it's considered to be unreliable by Muslim scholars. So there's not, even in the life of the Prophet and in the at least normative practice of Muslim jurists of Islamic civilization, which is obviously a huge time and space expanse, but in general, you see that there's not an acceptance of vigilante justice. So, you know, people have to have due process. Yes?
What I found different in the last 2 or 3 years was the condemnation from Muslim polities of what goes on in non-Muslim polities. I'm wondering if there's anything that you can draw upon that shows that that's legitimate.
Like, what do you mean, what goes on in
when there's an insult of a prophet in a non-Muslim polity country, but that condemnation can come from a Muslim country?
I mean, I think that this is perhaps best approached just a recognition of now a globalized media environment, and that it's become, quite common for countries to comment on the issues of their concern that go on in other countries, and not just, not just, let's say, things like Great Britain or Russia or France complaining to the Ottoman Empire about the treatment of Christians inside the Ottoman Empire. But I mean, that might be a substantive concern. But we don't like the way we're portrayed. I remember there was this one Turkish town which tried to sue DC Comics because the town's called Batman. They wanted to sue. I don't think that suit went anywhere. But I mean, the point is that there's, there's a trend in global media and law and just modes of and mechanisms for accountability where considered acceptable that people make demands about the behavior of. And again, this is really about power. It's really about if the United States can get a country to change its internal discourse to suit the United States' demands, that's an expression of power. If a country that's not that powerful can try to make that demand, it's an attempt to assert, sort of use the global regime of rule of law or of at least kind of motions of global civility to exert power on otherwise more powerful nations. Yes.
I think this is, again, like exploring the nuance of power, but like as a Muslim that lives in America that's very involved in the Muslim religious community, how do you recommend talking about things like Palestinian poet that Saudi sentenced to death for so-called like leaving Islam or saying something that they found to be offensive to Islam? Because I wouldn't agree with something like that.
So it's tough. I think it's really, I just got this email the other day. Because I'm working at the Alwaleed Law Center, everyone thinks that giant wads of cash from Saudi Arabia every month or something like that. He gave one-time gift, no strings attached, right? Someone sent me this email saying, why don't you guys say something about, the Saudi, something in Saudi Arabia. First of all, I think it's wrong that someone. I don't think people should be condemned to death for freedom, for issues of conscience. I don't think they should be condemned to death for statements that are made or artistic expression. Having said that, unless you happen to have been in the courtroom when this guy had his trial or have some access to information about the case. It's very hard from, you know, reading like a New York Times story or Huffington Post blog piece, it's very hard to go from that to saying you have any real idea what is really going on in the case. So you read about this, something's happening in Iran, something's happening in Syria. Even if you were interested in those topics, it's very hard to know really in a way that you feel comfortable making a statement. You know, I condemn this, I condemn that. That's why I think it's much more useful to just make statements about principles. You know, I as a Muslim and as an American don't believe people should be executed for freedom for issues of conscience. Now, if somebody has issue of conscience that then makes them commit grand high treason, let's say like Jonathan Pollard, and steal all this intelligence information from the United States military and give it to Israel because he has a religious national identification.
He was just released.
I mean, that person can be punished, right? But just an issue of a matter of conscience, that can't be punished. If someone has an issue of conscience that causes them to threaten public order, as an American, I don't really buy public order defenses. I think that they're grossly misused in, no offense, many European countries. But I'm sure not Norway. I mean, you can see the way I think it's really misused in France. So niqab is violation of public order. Hijab in school, violation of public order. You know, a 10-year-old girl with a headscarf is a violation of public order, okay? But in France, just in November, French government court, the high administrative court, it was the Court of Cassation, the highest court, upheld the criminalization of boycott that was sanctioned to the movement to engage in peaceful boycott of Israeli products. That is a crime in France. It is a crime in France to wear a t-shirt that says, don't buy Israeli goods. What? Yeah, so, I mean, imagine that. It's a crime to have something written on your shirt saying, don't buy Israeli goods. Because that's, according to the French Court of Cassation, it defames a religious group. But you can have a magazine that publishes incredibly insulting things about it. It insults every single Muslim in France. That's acceptable, that's real. So you can see how these, I think that these things are, as an American, I don't really buy the way these things are used. But I think it's also important, there has to be some degree of deferral to the national legal system. So if you look at, let's say, European Court of Human Rights, there's a very high degree of deference to national legal systems, even on issues of freedom of speech. So it's tough. How do you balance like respecting Iranian sovereignty or respecting Saudi sovereignty, respecting British sovereignty, while still insisting on promoting the principles of probably don't want to keep you guys any longer, so I did you a little bit of time. Well, you're the boss. You tell me.
Well, if there's no burning questions, I should be happy.
Are you tired?
I don't care. I'm okay. I'm high on whatever the caffeine I drank.
It takes a few more minutes. Yeah.
Yes. Quick question. In terms of comparing the Persian age versus Arab views on the representation of the Prophet, is it also the case that Shia in Arab-speaking regions, so for instance, northern border of Saudi, do they represent
the Prophet? That is a really good question. That is that's actually a great question. I think that would be anybody want to write an article about that? I mean, so, because when you go to Iran, one of the first things that struck me is you see pictures of the imams everywhere. I wish I brought examples of Iran has government sanctioned efforts to kind of go back and forensically reconstruct what the Prophet looked like. I mean, these are government sanctioned, government approved by an Islamic Republic. So it's so far, it's so different from the kind of iconoclastic sentiment you find. I've characterized a sort of Arab world. I know it's a clumsy distinction, but it seems the division is very clear. I think it would be really interesting to look at where the fault line is. So that's a great question. I will try and find the answer, and I'll send it to Terry. And if not, then someone else can do an article and send it to me. Someone else, wait, other gentleman in front of the other guy who already asked a question.
No, yeah.
In one of your books, you said that the hadith about the 72 virgins, you made a little question mark. Can you expand on that?
Not in the top, yeah, I mean, there's an appendix at the end of the book where I discuss, so Everyone's heard this hadith. Anybody who's seen The Family Guy or Bill Maher, anything, knows about the 72 virgins, right? So if you're a martyr, you get 72 virgins when you go to paradise. This is not from the Quran, it's from a hadith. The hadith itself is not a reliable hadith. So and that's such is my opinion. Many Muslim scholars argue this is not a reliable hadith. Why is it included in Muslim hadith collections then? Because every culture thinks martyrdom is good. So now Independence Day 2 is coming out. In Independence Day 1, Randy Quaid goes and he jams the airplane up into the laser hole of the alien airplane and kills himself, and then everyone says, he died a good man. So everybody, every society thinks it's good to die for a good cause. So what Muslim scholars said is, this seems like it's helpful to encourage people. We're not sure the Prophet didn't say it, so. But then there's another hadith just a few pages later in that collection that says, the lowest level of people in paradise. So martyrs are one of the highest level in paradise. The lowest level gets 70 heavenly beauties. So you're talking about a marginal difference of two. So but the reason that Muslims, I'm not trying to glaze it, Muslim scholars didn't take these hadiths very seriously because, again, they already knew martyrdom was good, so they're just kind of piling material on to encourage people to be martyrs. Yes?
Okay, I would like to give you two scenarios and see what's the context, because we are focusing on the idea of the people who are going into mobs because there was someone insulted the Prophet. But think about this, for example, in Pakistan, it happened that there was a mob that where they were very violent because of that, but also, just yesterday I was listening to the news and they were talking about there was a mob and also a bomb that killed more than, I think, 15 people in front of the polio places where they do the polio vaccines. So here, I mean, these are people who are coming from the Muslim community and doing this kind of acts. So when we talk about situations where there is violence, we always think about the religious aspect, what the religious understanding of the people, how people are religious, and the religiosity or the type of religiosity. But we completely forget what is the basis of this violence. I mean, for me, for someone who goes and kill innocent people in front of the people who are going to the vaccine, there is more probably there was a more like a basis for it that is very political. So how are we going to talk about the discourse of religion when there are many other discourses that we are not including?
I think one of the problems in America and in general American European media discourse about stuff that happens in the Muslim world is that religion is always discussed. So I think that there's, this is my opinion, but in the case of, let's say, this obsessive discussion, is ISIS Islamic? Is ISIS the real Islam? Is this the real, are they really true Muslims? Is this the real face of Islam? Every Muslim scholar, I only know of one Muslim scholar in the world, Turki al-Bin Ali, who works for ISIS, who supports ISIS. Sunni, Shia, Salafi, Sufi, liberal, conservative, establishment, Islamist. Everyone else I know of condemns ISIS, either as heretics or as non-Muslims. Okay? So, no, they do not represent Islam. And why is American media obsessed with talking about this? Because if you're talking about this and you're not talking about the actual cause of ISIS, which is the destruction of the political, social, economic infrastructure of Iraq, killing, anywhere between 150,000 and a million Iraqi civilians died as a result of the war. I mean, I think I calculated in America that would be like 19 million people. The highest level would be like 19 million dead. Imagine what it would do to this country. So the country was obliterated as a result of a totally unnecessary war, which, I mean, very few people would argue was a good idea to have a war. But, if Americans actually sat and thought about, maybe we shouldn't engage in military adventurism so easily, then they wouldn't be, you know, they can't be manipulated by the, you know, the media, military, industrial complex that leads people around by their noses towards whatever new war is being sought out. So I think there's a purpose to making everything about religion. It doesn't, a lot of people talk about the real issues. It prevents them from talking about real issues and examining their own policies. Thanks very much.